Hey everyone, and welcome back to another Tuesday tip, where in this week's video we're going to be talking about BMX handlebar geometry. So if you're new here, every Tuesday I try to make a tips and tricks video on everything from working on your bike, making working on your bike easier, to doing tricks while actually riding your bike. And as I said, this week we're going to be talking about BMX handlebar geometry. It's actually a fairly simple subject, and a lot of it has to do with personal preference, but there are some stats there to go over, and there's a few extra things that we can talk about just to put a little bit more meat on the bones of this video. So when it comes to handlebar geometry, there's four main measurements that we can take a look at. Those are rise, width, upsweep, and backsweep. But before we get into those, let's talk about the other topics that I mentioned previously. There's three of those, and those are the type of metal that the handlebars are actually made of, heat treating, and tube budding. When it comes to the type of metal that the handlebars are made of, there's two different types of metal that bars are usually made of, and that is 4130 chromoly and high-ten steel. And the differences between the two have to do with strength and weight. 4130 is stronger than high-ten steel, therefore it allows you to use thinner tubing, which makes it so your handlebars are lighter. And most of the time we only see high-ten steel bars on complete bikes. And if I were to give any advice on this subject, if you're going to be doing anything more than riding in circles, doing bunny hops in your driveway, you need to have 4130 bars on your bike, because you do not want to deal with your bars breaking, because usually handlebars break right about here or right here beside the stem. And if they break right here, what you're dealing with is basically a shank on this end of the bars, and that's not something that you want to risk falling into. So if you're doing anything more than just doing bunny hops and riding in circles, get 4130 bars if you don't already have them. When it comes to heat treating, this is another process that is done to make your bars stronger, and this is done on 4130 chromoly metal. And basically it's a process done to change the properties of the metal by heating it up to a certain temperature for a certain period of time. It's supposed to make the metal stronger, but if it's done improperly, it can actually make the metal weaker. There's companies out there like Odyssey who have their patented 41 thermal heat treating process that is guaranteed against bending and breaking for life. So it's clear that they put a lot of trust into their heat treating process, and it's clear that we can too. So like I said before, this is another thing that you definitely want to have in your handlebars if you're doing more than just riding in circles and doing bunny hops in your driveway. So now that we've talked about the metal that actually makes the bars up and the heat treating process that's supposed to make them stronger, there's another thing that has to do with the bars makeup that we can talk about, and that is tube budding. Tube budding is the process of strategically thickening tubing in places where it's more necessary to have thicker tubing and more strength. So for example, there's a diagram that I'll show on screen now that shows on fly handlebars, the tubing is 1.6 millimeters thick on the bends around the bottom where it goes into the stem. And then as it goes up the bars, the tubing is only 1 millimeter thick. And then we approach the bend again and it's 1.6 millimeters again. Then as we approach where the grip goes, in the middle there, it's only 1 millimeter thick. And then towards the end, it's 1.6 millimeters thick again. This process is supposed to make the bars stronger and strategically save weight in places where it's not necessary. This is also done on frames strategically. This is something that's done by a lot of different companies and has been for a long time. So it's definitely something that a lot of people put trust in. But just like anything else, it's good to be informed that it exists so that you can make an informed decision whenever you're buying your handlebars. Because like I said before, having a shank on the end of your bars or breaking them down here, just breaking bars in general, is not something that you ever want to experience. But now that we've talked about those three different topics that don't have as much to do with the geometry, let's move on to the geometry itself. And first we'll talk about rise. Rise is the measurement from the very top of the tubing on the grip side to the very bottom of the tubing where it goes in the stem. Typically these days we see a lot of people running anywhere from 8.5 to 10-inch rise bars. I think there's even been some that are higher. And this measurement is something that can be impacted by another one of the terms we'll be talking about, and that is upsweep. But before we get there, let's talk about the width. And pretty clearly, This is just the measurement from the end of the bar here to the end of the bar here. That is the width, and we see everything these days from 27 to 31, maybe even 32 if it exists. I know I have a friend who runs 31 inch wide bars, or at least he did. I run my bars at 28 and a half inches wide, which is a personal preference for me, and it's just what these bars came in when I got them, and I didn't feel like cutting them, so I got used to it, and it feels good to me. Width of your bars is really up to personal preference. I mean, if you've been riding long enough, you know that the trend used to be super, super skinny bars for bar spins, and then it moved to very, very wide bars, and personally, I believe that the sweet spot is right in the middle of those, which is in that 28 and a half width range. One thing that I didn't mention yet is that rise is the only handlebar geometry factor that is generally accepted to have an effect on your riding. And that is because the higher the rise of your bars, the less hunched over you are. And if you ride bikes for long enough, you know that the more hunched over you are, the more lower back pain you have. But this is also something that can be supplemented by getting a top load stem. These bars are 8.5 inches in rise, which before I got a top load stem would lead to lower back pain almost every time I rode. But as soon as I switched to a top load stem, which effectively does the exact same thing as raising the rise on your bars, the back pain went away and I didn't have to get taller bars to do it. So that's definitely something that you can consider if you have access to a top load stem and you want to try having your bars higher. Some people need both. Some people need a top load stem and taller rise bars because they're 8 feet tall or whatever it might be. But like I said, with the width, it's also down to personal preference because some people like being hunched over or feel they ride better that way, and some people feel like they ride better whenever they're standing taller, even if they're not really tall enough to make the numbers for higher rise bars make sense. It's all down to personal preference, and that leads me into upsweep and backsweep. Upsweep is the measurement of how far your bars are bent upward, and backsweep is the measurement of how far your bars are bent backwards. These bars are bent 2 degrees up and 10 degrees back. And this is something that can have an effect on how your wrists feel whenever you're riding. If they're too far forward, your wrists will be bent a certain way, and it can be uncomfortable for some people, but it can also be comfortable for others. These two measurements, upsweep and backsweep, are things that are completely down to personal preference and how it makes you feel while you're riding. In some instances, there's different disciplines of riding that take different geometry on the handlebars. It's common for flatland riders to have less backsweep and upsweep in their bars than it is for someone who rides freestyle and jumps dirt jumps, for example, because it's said that more backsweep gives you more control in turning, which is something that you definitely want whenever you're riding dirt jumps and going very fast. But in flatland, they move their bars backwards a lot, and having a lot of backsweep and upsweep dramatically changes the feel of your bars whenever they're backwards, whereas if you didn't have backsweep and upsweep, your bars would pretty much feel the same both forwards and backwards. They would just be further back and closer to you whenever they're backwards. Now that's really all that there is to talk about when it comes to the geometry itself, because most of the factors with bar geometry are all down to personal preference and what you think things feel like whenever you're riding and how you are comfortable with your bars while you're riding your bike. But there's a couple other things that we have to talk about. The first of those is different crossbars in BMX handlebars. For example, I have the Nowhere Candy bars, and these are bent downwards to allow for different clearances for different tricks like candy bars and other stuff like that. And there's other bars that even have a straight crossbar with different shapes, like Scotty Kramer's Jackson bars, I think they're called. They have a good example of outside butting on the tubing where they're thicker towards the ends of the crossbar and then it gets thinner in the center. So you can kind of look at those and visualize what butting might look like on the inside. It's just, it's convex versus the concave of the Scotty Kramer bars. Then there's Shadow with their teardrop shaped crossbars. There's a ton of different examples of handlebars with different shaped crossbars these days. They're very common, and to my knowledge, they don't have an effect on the handlebars structurally. And there's also different styles of handlebars in the number of tubes that make up the bars themselves. If you look at these handlebars, we've got one long tube here, and then we've got the crossbar. These would be called two-piece bars. And then there's four-piece handlebars. If you look here, I've got a four-piece example of the bars that I was just showing. We have the longer tubes here that make up the grip area and the down part of the bars. Then we've got the crossbar, and then we've got the tubing that goes into the stem itself. These are four-piece handlebars. The ones that I was just showing were two-piece handlebars. And while they're much less common, there's also six-piece handlebars in BMX. The gripping area is made up of two tubes on their own. Then we've got the tubing that goes down, so there's two more tubes. Then we've got the crossbar and the tube that goes into the stem. So in all, they make up six pieces to make the six-piece handlebars. I think Hoffman still makes a pair of these. I'm not 100% sure, but they exist. And that's everything that we have to talk about when it comes to BMX handlebars and their geometry. If you enjoyed this video, hit the subscribe button. It's free. There's no reason not to. And I will be coming out with more Tuesday tips every single time that I have something to talk about on any given Tuesday. I also do a BMX news video on Fridays with any other types of riding videos in between. So thanks for watching. I hope you found this video useful, and we'll see you next time. Goodbye.